There was an artist named Neil Adams, and then you had the writer Denny O'Neill, and what they started to do were stories that were much more naturalistic and not funny.
Denny and Neil seek out a platform where they can express themselves, not only artistically, but politically. Throughout the Silver Age, Green Lantern had been off fighting crime in outer space.
I thought of him as a cop, but the best cop who ever lived. A really competent, decent man, but one who thought his job was to carry out orders.
And in one issue, Denny and Neil bring him crashing down to Earth.
And we needed somebody to articulate the non-establishment viewpoint. And we had this rebel, Green Arrow, this arrow-slinging guy who didn't trust anybody over 30, in fact, didn't probably trust anybody wearing a necktie.
Not all these characters were invented, obviously, when there was a lot of thought going into who they really are behind the mask and behind the powers. And Green Arrow was one of those characters, and as soon as they took him and pushed him in this different direction, not only did it make sense, it was very unique. It was something that was, I think, desperately needed in the DC Universe and in comics in general.
First six pages of that story are significantly important in comic books in that they broke so many rules. It got into black versus white, it got into integration, it got into rich versus poor. This man was emptying tenements of people who couldn't pay their rent. And a young man was attacking him on the street, not really doing much to him, just shoving him. Why? Didn't matter why to Green Lantern. Green Lantern beat him up, sent him off to jail. And then Green Arrow watched the neighborhood throw garbage on Green Lantern and then explained to him why. See that old lady over there? That young man that you just put in jail is her only source of income. And when that fat pig downstairs throws everybody out of this building, they're not going to have any place to live, and he's going to level it and turn it into a supermarket. And that's what you did today. Page six, an old black man turns to Green Lantern and he says, I've seen that you've done lots of things for people on another planet out there with purple skins. Have you ever done anything for people with black skins?
You're doing all that stuff for the extraterrestrials. You're not dealing with problems right under your feet.
Not only Green Lantern, but every American that you could scratch had not done anything for their brothers. That was a time of change. Remember the 60s? Big changes in America. And that was right there in that comic book. Bam, right in your face.
Green Lantern and Green Arrow embark on a quest across America, confronting real-world problems. They discover racism, government corruption, labor strife, overpopulation, and poverty.
It forced Green Lantern and through him, the readers, to look at America as it really was at that time.
Denny and Neil grow the Green Lantern family to include John Stewart, DC's first African-American superhero without the word black in his name.
We practically destroyed the comics code. We attacked Nixon and Agnew in our comic book pages. Governor of Florida wrote a letter to DC Comics and said they weren't going to distribute DC Comics in Florida if we do one more thing like that.
Under the Comics Code Authority, one of the biggest taboos is the depiction of drug use.
And I drew a cover. Speedy, Green Arrow's ward, was in the foreground, the bags under his eyes, and the fixins for a heroin injection. And in the background is Green Arrow looking on in shock, and Green Lantern turning to him and saying, so you're such a big deal. How come your ward is a drug addict? Cover. Took it into DC Comics and gave it to Julie Schwartz, and I said, this should be our next issue. And Julie said, gah! We undid 15, 20 years of lousy comics. So DC became the company that brought new artists. So you got a tremendous amount of experimenting.